Hey there, space fans. Welcome to our live Stargazers virtual event, Mission to Mars. Today, we're going to find out what exactly it takes to get all the way to the Red Planet. We've got some great guests to explain the science behind it all and what the future holds for space travel. I'd like to thank our partner for this program, Florida Atlantic University. This stream was inspired by a class there called Human Mission to Mars, and we're going to learn more about that in a little bit. So, first, I want to welcome Stargazers resident space expert, Dr. Atta Sarachandani. He holds the Bjorn Lamborn Endowed Chair in Astrophysics at Florida Atlantic University. Hi, Atta. And I also want to welcome our first guest, Katie Dickieson. She is an FAU alumna now furthering her studies at Cornell University. And she's getting her master's in biomedical engineering with her research focused on growing things in Martian soil, which is super cool. Welcome, y'all. Hi.
Thank you. Hello. It's good to be here.
Before we get into it, though, I want to remind those watching live that you can send us your questions about Mars and space travel and all sorts of stuff to the comment section. It's on Facebook. You can also do that, and we will get to them as soon as possible. But first, let's jump into it. Dr. Sarachandani, Atta, Mars exploration has been a super popular subject for so many years. Can you tell our viewers a little bit about what we have accomplished so far in terms of getting to Mars?
Okay, yeah. I really want to just give you a very short summary of the kind of the big picture view of what we've done so far. And the missions that we've sent to Mars so far really fall into four different categories. Flyby missions, orbiting spacecraft, landing spacecraft, and rover spacecraft. And so the first ones, of course, were the flybys in the 1960s. First successful flyby was in 1965, 55 years ago now. First orbiting spacecraft that was successful in going into orbit around Mars was in 1971, the U.S. mission Mariner 9. And then the first successful landing spacecraft on the surface of Mars were the Viking 1 and 2, and that was 44 years ago in 1976. And then moving on to the rover spacecraft, those have been, of course, the ones that have gotten, that at least recently have gotten the most press attention, were the Sojourner spacecraft in 1997, Spirit and Opportunity in 2004, Curiosity in 2012, and recently the launch of Perseverance, which is going to arrive on the surface of Mars in 2021. Just to give you a sense of the sizes of these things, Sojourner was about the size of a microwave oven, Spirit and Opportunity are about the size of a golf cart, and Curiosity and Perseverance are more the size of a typical car. And so we'll talk more about Perseverance as we go along in this broadcast. But that's kind of the big picture view of what we've done in terms of exploring Mars as a planet.
What is it about Mars? I mean, why we've sent, it sounds like robot. Where's the people? When are we going to send humans to Mars? That's my question.
That's a very good question. And so, yeah, I mean, depending on who you talk to, it could be the technology, it could be the cost, it could be the resolve. We don't have the resolve to do all those things, but as I'll talk later in the broadcast, in this class we taught here at Florida Atlantic University called Human Mission to Mars, we use this book called The Case for Mars by Dr. Robert Zubrin. And in that book, Dr. Zubrin really makes the case that we can go to Mars today. We have the technology to go today. And the reason we don't or haven't is because of resolve. We can send people to Mars today, and we haven't done so because we don't have the resolve as a society to actually do it and put together the technology that we need and actually go through with it. That's his point of view. So I guess I'll leave it at that. That's really, you know, what he believes is the reason why we haven't gone there.
Katie, what about you? What do you believe? Do you think that it's because we have resolve? I mean, have you always been interested in Mars and space exploration? Do you think we're going to go there?
The short answer is yes. I didn't actually think of pursuing it as a career until the class Human Mission to Mars. It really did change my life. I almost felt like my dreams that I had thought were long gone were lost to that might have been lost to the world were completely reignited. And Zubrin had a lot to do with that. And in my mind, I don't understand why we're not already there.
Yeah, I totally hear that. But I like that you say that because I would also love for us to go to Mars. I mean, it'd be amazing. But I do want to ask, like, as somebody who took this class and you know, knows a little bit more about Mars than maybe the average person, why do you think we should go? Why is it important to go to Mars if we've already sent all these robots, especially?
I think there is a huge impact that would happen in the space and technology fields when you do that. If you look back at the Apollo missions and the spike that happened in people that actually went into scientific fields and technology fields, during that time with that spike is where we got most of the technology that we use today. But when you look back at that, minorities and females weren't really a part of it. So if we were to do that today, if there was a new space race that was created, it would just create such a huge camaraderie. Not only the camaraderie of bringing people together for furthering our future as a whole, but even the aspect of potentially being able to protect the world if, let's say, there was an asteroid that came towards the Earth, or just the mere idea of studying or trying to terraform Mars. If we choose to terraform Mars, then in that aspect, we will be able to possibly figure out how to save our own planet from global warming and climate change.
That's a great answer. And I think spreading humans around and trying to make sure that we don't get eliminated by one rogue asteroid, definitely on board for that. I would rather us be able to stick around after that. Most recent news, though, in Mars exploration was that NASA launched Perseverance, the rover, the Curiosity twin. And Dr. Sarojadini, what are the goals of Perseverance?
Right. Well, there's three main goals of the Perseverance mission, the rover itself, and its accompanying drone that's going to actually fly around the surface of Mars. It's going to search for signs of microbial life, study Mars's geology and its climate. And I think the most amazing goal is to collect rock and sediment samples for possible return to Earth. NASA has a plan in place to actually send a rocket to Mars, collect these samples that Perseverance is going to put together, and bring them back to Earth. And once they get into an Earth, you know, a laboratory here on Earth, we'll really be able to study those samples and really, really dissect what's in there and really better understand about the geology of Mars, and also really get a chance to test those samples for the possibility of life. I mean, to me, that's probably one of the most exciting aspects of the Perseverance mission.
Absolutely. Sounds incredible. I don't think I'd ever get to hold a Mars rock. There wouldn't be that many, but like just the fact that we know that they're here would be awesome. We do have a short clip from NASA showing the historic launch of Perseverance. It was only a couple months ago, back in July. So let's play that.
Status check. Go Atlas.
Go Centaur.
Go Mars 2020.
There we go. We're ready to go lift off this morning, Joshua. Eight, seven, six, five, four, engine ignition, 2, 1, 0.
Release.
And liftoff. As the countdown to Mars continues, the perseverance of humanity launching the next generation of robotic explorers to the Red Planet.
And Atlas TU has gone to closed loop control.
That is so cool. I never get over seeing a rocket launch. It's so awesome. We've gotten a couple of viewer questions, so I want to get to those real quick. McKay Brown from East Texas and Sam Silverstein both want to know how long it takes to get to Mars. I don't know which one of you is going to jump on this one, but I think that one, a pretty good question.
Well, I think let me just address that. When Mars and the Earth are optimally positioned relative to each other, as they were this past summer, then Perseverance, for example, will arrive on the surface of Mars on February 18th of 2021. So it's roughly between 6 and 7 months when the two planets are optimally positioned for a rocket to get from the Earth to go to Mars.
Yeah. And so I like that you said it's optimally positioned because both of our planets are orbiting the sun. So they sometimes are far apart and sometimes close together. So how far, Katie, do you know how far away Mars is? Like, we can see it in the night sky, right? So do we know how far
roughly
away it is?
37 million miles away.
Wow. 36. That's a bit, and take a while to drive there.
Yeah, probably.
Yes. I mean, the position actually exactly varies, of course, because of the elliptical shape of the orbits trace. But you're right. Katie's right. It's between 30 and 40 million miles or so. And right now you can actually see Mars in the sky in the constellation of Pisces rising in the east around 9 or 10 in the evening.
It's beautiful.
Yeah, it's a really good view of Mars right now. It's awesome.
Yes, yes.
Sorry, Katie, I jumped right on there for you. I was also excited.
No, it's okay. It's okay. Now that I'm in New York, the sky is so much clearer up here, and it's so orange and so bright over the lake. It's just, it's amazing to see it rising at night.
So awesome. Dr. Sarojadini, can you tell us a bit about this class that we brought up earlier, the Human Mission to Mars course? What did the students learn? What were the goals?
Right. So the class was actually designed around what I've heard people refer to as the four C's: communication, collaboration, creativity, and critical thinking. The class was designed to foster and encourage those skills in the students. So the students were given material related to a human mission to Mars outside of class. They came to class looking to work together to solve problems. They worked in small groups, were given problems to solve together, and then communicate their solutions to other members of their group and the rest of the class. So in solving these problems, they practiced their communication skills, practiced working together, the collaboration part. They practiced thinking creatively about solving the problems in a different kind of out-of-the-box way. And they practice their critical thinking skills. How do you actually assess a problem and propose a solution that actually makes sense? And so this is how the class was designed, to really foster and encourage and build these skills that I and others have called the four C's. And of course, Katie can talk more about how those skills went over and how they were developed.
Yeah, Katie, that was my next question. Kind of pop quiz. Let's see what you remember from the class. Like, how do you think we're going to get to Mars? Can we build a permanent settlement? And how would we live there? Just give us the lowdown.
All right. So it was really cool. Just like Dr. Atta was saying, we had groups of four people, right? So in our groups, minus especially, we had a biologist, a geologist, a chemist, and a physicist. So we had every different component. And when we would start class, every week would have a different thing we would have to solve, right? And in aspect to getting to Mars or having a settlement, when it comes to actually living on Mars, when you think about it, if it's going to take you 6 to 7 months to get there, the last thing that you want to do is have to build your house when you get there. Could you imagine you're already losing your muscle mass, part of your muscle mass and your bone mass, and then you get there and you're like, wait, I have nowhere to go. So the best thing that you can possibly do is to send 3D printers to Mars that will actually build your hub on the planet so that when you get there, you will already have a place to live.
Yeah, that makes sense. I mean, just so in case people are unaware, a 6 month journey in space, you're going to lose muscle mass, you're going to lose bone mass because there's no gravity pulling you down and your body's not fighting that gravity to keep that muscle mass up. So even when you get to Mars, you're weaker than when you left Earth, even with exercise in space. It's kind of a mess. So how do you think we would end up living there, though? I mean, once we get there, we've got this habitat that hopefully is already popped up for us. So then what do we do?
So it's funny because I was talking about this with someone the other day and we realized that it's kind of equivalent to the way quarantine was back in March, where you have to have this mentality of just staying indoors, but at the same time trying to keep your mental and physical aspects intact so that you don't go crazy. So there is a lot of working out. A lot of astronauts say who are on the ISS for a long time that if they go one day without working out, they can almost feel their bones starting to crumble. That's how they've described it. So, I mean, there's a lot of different things besides the working out, besides keeping your nutrition. The thing is that you can create your own propellant off of Mars. You can start growing plants, not necessarily in the soil right away, but through aeroponics and hydroponics, you can do that. And I feel like a lot of it is keeping busy and doing a lot of experimentation, looking for life in the water that we have now realized that exists there.
Yeah. I mean, I'm sure we would have no shortage of things to do. And like with the International Space Station, the people that are even on Mars are going to be a big source of information, just what it's like to live there, what happens to our bodies, and so on. So I want to ask one last question here before we move on. But Emily Roll Tate wants to know, says, my grandson wants to know what the temperature is on Mars. And my granddaughter, Holly, wants to know how old Mars is. Atta, you got this for Holly and for Emily there and her grandson?
Yeah, the daytime temperatures are actually pretty cold. They're maybe 20 or so degrees Fahrenheit. That's the high. The lows are down in the -100 range, -120, 130 range. So in Fahrenheit. So yeah, it's pretty cold on the surface. So yeah, it would not be a fun place to live without some kind of protection. And then the other question was, I'm sorry, what?
Oh, the other question was then, how old is Mars? How long has it been up there?
Yes. Right. So Mars is the same age as the rest of the planets and sun in the solar system, which would be 4.5 billion years. That's how long ago we think the solar system was formed. So 4.5 billion years.
It's a long time. That's an old planet.
Yes.
It's got a lot of knowledge up there. Hopefully we can learn a lot about it. Katie, did you end up studying more space stuff quickly? And did you go on to do that because of this class?
Oh yeah, there's no way I would be where I am right now without that class. The day actually that I met Robert Zubrin pretty much changed my life. He has become one of my mentors, same with Dr. Atta. Dr. Atta is the one who introduced me to Robert personally that day. And now I am working in Chris Mason's lab, who he's actually the one who did the twins, was part of the twin study for the Kelly brothers. And I'm going to be working with simulant that NASA makes based on Martian soil. And we already know that we can plant and grow things on Martian soil. But the one thing, there's actually multiple aspects, but one of the things that I'm going to be testing is for toxicity in the soil and how we can use microbes to potentially alter that soil to make sure that when we do end up growing plants on Mars, that we're able to eat the food that we're growing, because there's so much perchlorate and like I said, the toxicity from the metals in there, that if we can use microbes and other plants that can absorb that toxicity, then we will actually be able to eat that food while also hopefully starting to terraform Mars in the process as well.
Dang, that's cool. Oh, man. Okay. Well, Katie, thank you so much for joining us. Thanks for telling us about your studies and getting me more excited about Mars than I thought I could get. I was already pretty excited. So thank you so much, Katie. And everyone, thank you for sending in your questions. We've had so many good questions. Stay tuned. In a couple of minutes, we've got two NASA experts with us to talk more about traveling to Mars. But first, we have this short video that shows just how scientists are using virtual reality to explore Mars. Super cool.
The Curiosity rover landed on Mars on August 5th, 2012. Since then, it's sent over 200,000 images back to Earth. NASA engineers have transformed these photographs into a 3D model that our scientists use to study the surface of Mars. We wanted to share this tool with everyone, so we collaborated with Google to create an immersive web experience called Access Mars.
Hi, I'm Katie. Welcome to Mars.
Access Mars features some of the most important locations from the mission, key points of interest, and narration from JPL scientist Katie Stack Morgan.
It lives on the web, so you don't need to install anything to check it out. You can view it on a computer, phone, or a VR device.
And because Curiosity is still on Mars, we will continue to update the data so you can see where the rover is right now. Our scientists are virtually exploring Mars with this technology, and now you can too.
That is so cool. I cannot wait to explore Mars in VR, you know, or in person, maybe someday. Joining us now is Dr. James Rice. He's an astrogeologist who's worked on several Mars explorations missions with NASA. And we also, of course, have my friend Babak Ferdowsi, a systems engineer at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory here in California. He's worked on a whole bunch of projects, including the Mars Curiosity rover. Thanks for being here, you guys.
My pleasure.
Good to see you guys.
So it's the dream job of so many people to work in the field of space exploration. You are both doing that. So I'm sure it was your childhood dream. Maybe it wasn't. I hope it was. What inspired you to get into this, Dr. Rice?
It was my childhood ambition. I've been interested in space since I was 6 years old. And that's all I've ever really been interested in. And it just fascinated me. I grew up in the 60s with the Apollo program. And they were talking earlier about the inspiration. The Apollo program is why I do what I do. As a kid, I watched it happen. Over the years, I've got to know a lot of the Apollo astronauts and engineers. And it's an amazing feat this country pulled off. And it's a gift that keeps on giving in terms of science. We're still analyzing moon rocks to this day that the crews brought back. And anyone around my age will tell you that went to the science or engineering fields, 9 times out of 10, the Apollo program inspired them.
What about you, Babak? Why did you get into space exploration and space engineering?
I'm probably too much of a sci-fi nerd, honestly. And I just grew up on the idea that space would bring us together. And I think it does in many ways. I just love the concept that like space was this challenge that humanity could take on, and that we could, you know, participate in, and hopefully, you know, look like Curiosity has and other missions back home at Earth and really recognize how special our place is in the universe.
Yeah, absolutely. Dr. Rice, you worked on the Spirit and Opportunity rovers. And Opportunity, I mean, wow, what a machine, that little guy. Can you tell us about your career and your role with these rovers and, you know, all the stuff that they taught us about Mars?
Yeah, it involved doing a lot of degree, alphabet soup into your name, bachelor's degree, master's, PhD over the years. But like I said, at an early age, I knew this is what I wanted to do. And so I had to bite the bullet and do a lot of schoolwork, which wasn't something as a grade school student that anybody thought I'd probably end up doing. My grades weren't that great growing up. But like I said, the space program is in my blood. I'm just still fascinated with it to this day. As I got my PhD, I was doing research with professors on Mars related topics. I'm a geologist. So when I got selected by NASA to be on the science team for Spirit and Opportunity, that was to me a dream come true, to work on actually two rovers on Mars. That's something that's not even on the books to do again. So it was a very unique project to send two rovers to Mars in 2003. They landed in January 2004. I was the geology team leader on both those rovers. And we had a great team of scientists and engineers. And it was an amazing journey. I mean, our mission was only supposed to last about 90 days, and Spirit went close to 15 years. Excuse me, Opportunity went close to 15 years. Spirit was about 6.5 years. So I think the U.S. taxpayer should feel good, because they really definitely got a return on their investment of these vehicles for lasting so long. We made amazing discoveries. For me personally, my PhD dissertation was on ancient lakes on Mars. And in the 1990s, this was a very controversial subject. When you went to technical conferences, you were ostracized if you were talking about lakes on Mars. So I was involved, fortunate to be involved with the paradigm shift in thinking of Mars. And then to me, the icing on the cake was to work on the Opportunity rover when we found the first lake beds on Mars. And so that was an amazing journey for me personally and professionally. And we discovered so much about Mars. We basically rewrote the science book on Mars and laid the foundation for missions that came later, like Curiosity. You know, we found, like I said, lake beds on Mars, an area where there could have been a hot spring or a geyser on Mars with Spirit, abundant evidence of past water on Mars. and all these environments were potentially could have been habitable if there were any Martians there. Now, we still don't know if there was ever life on Mars, but definitely we discovered environments that would have been conducive for life. And, you know, it was an amazing, I still have a hard time believing the mission's over, because after 15 years, it was so exciting to get new pictures down from the rover every day, because you never knew what you were going to see. And being a geologist team leader, that was my job, to analyze the images and to help figure out where we're going to drive the rover next. And like I said, we're a great team.
I love that you got to see these images. And correct me if I'm wrong, but you got to see pictures of Mars that no one had ever seen before first, like right out of the gate. That's crazy. I bet that.
Absolutely. Even, you know, late into the mission, 13, 14 years of mission, I would still get up in the middle of the night when the downlink would occur to watch the images when they came down. Yeah, I was just, to me, this was an opportunity of a lifetime to work on two rovers. And early in the mission, when we first landed during the prime mission, we were all out at JPL and living on Mars time, which was very interesting. And I was the only person on the team that worked on both rovers. To me, I figured this would be my chance. And I didn't get much sleep, but I figured I could sleep in the grave. So it was a great experience.
We're going to come to the Curiosity rover and Bobek in a second, but I want to get to a couple audience questions. Trevor Dickison asks, what's the easiest way to get around on Mars? I think, Bobek, if you want to tackle that one, that could be really interesting.
Sure. I mean, obviously we have rovers for now, and I think the hope with Perseverance is to demonstrate that you can do flights on Mars and hopefully get around a lot more easily than the unpaved terrain of Mars. Certainly some of the more interesting places where it's very rocky and very difficult for rovers, you might be able to fly in. So I think we're hoping to prove that, kind of like Pathfinder proved you could drive on Mars. We'd like to prove next that, you know, you can fly on Mars.
That's cool. I can't believe we sent a helicopter to another planet. I mean, that's nuts. Another question. James Roney wants to know, looking down the road, what are some of the biggest technology challenges that we're going to face to having an ongoing presence on Mars? I mean, Dr. Rice, you had a machine that was there for 15 years. What kind of technology challenges did y'all run into?
Well, Mars, as we alluded to earlier, it's a very harsh place. It's a tough place to make a living. But, you know, we had some great engineers that built some great vehicles. And in terms of future challenges, I think robotically, every mission is a challenge. And you never know, it could be a bad day on Mars. I mean, there's no guarantee right now that Perseverance is going to land successfully. We think the team has done a great job to get ready for that as much as possible. And we're very confident. But, you know, Mars can reach out and really slap you upside the head. I worked on Mars Polar Lander, first Mars mission I worked on. And if you know anything about Mars exploration, you know that mission failed. It crashed. And this business, I would say, is not for the faint of heart, because bad things can happen. And when they happen, you kind of lose your job, you know, not because you did anything wrong, just because Mars is a very difficult place. You know, roughly half the missions that the planet Earth has sent to Mars have failed. So it's a tough place. Future challenges, I would say, the biggest future challenges, robotically, we've done a great job. And I think we'll still do a great job in the future with Perseverance and eventually the sample return. But I think the biggest challenge in terms of Mars exploration is going to be getting astronauts there. And that is the thing people always ask about. When are we going to put astronauts on Mars? And we have a lot of work to do before we do that. And but I think, you know, the skill set that our scientists and engineers have in this country, especially at the NASA centers, these are some fantastic people. And if, you know, we're given the resources to do it, I have no doubt we can solve these problems. It's in our nature to do these things.
Yeah. Bobek, you worked on the Mars Curiosity rover team, which was a huge success, still on Mars, still driving around. I mean, it had the seven minutes that everybody was freaking out, exactly like Jim was talking about, where you don't know what's going to happen and it could crash. And you had can you tell us a little bit about your role in the Curiosity rover mission?
Sure. So I worked as the integrated launch and cruise engineer, which was basically getting us from Earth to Mars. And kind of doing all the checkouts, making sure we could communicate with the Deep Space Network once we got into space, making sure that, of course, all the hardware was ready for the landing, and then checkouts on the surface. So it's kind of a hodgepodge of things, really, but mostly kind of the, at some level, the delivery guy, and trying to, make sure that the science team would have a safe landing on Mars and be ready to go once we were on the surface. And then, of course, continued from there into, being a flight director for that mission and helping operate it, not just, design and testing of that, but then operating it well into the first year of its mission. And just kind of like Jim was saying, get to participate in a lot of these firsts and experiencing the planet with that just incredible group of engineers and scientists who helped make this whole thing come together.
One of my favorite moments in space exploration is when something lands successfully, because you just get a room filled with nerds who have worked on this for years, who just let it all go. It's amazing. The 2012 Curiosity landing had to feel good. What was that like? What was that moment like for you?
Yeah, I mean, I didn't realize I was going to let it all go. And you're absolutely right. We had the dress rehearsals, We obviously test the hardware, but we also have to test the people. And we have these dress rehearsals, and they never quite go perfectly smoothly. And some of them are intentionally, like, they throw issues at you so you can, like, kind of cope with them and deal with them and, use your process to resolve them. But, I remember the landings of those, and people were just kind of tired and were like, okay, time to go home. Finally, the dress rehearsal's over. And I remember our project manager coming in. He's like, I hope you guys are a little more excited when we land on Mars. And sure enough, of course, right? Like, I didn't think I was going to cry, but just being there in that room with so many other people and just knowing what all of us had kind of put into that, I don't even think I understood how invested I was in that mission at some level. And really, like, I think there was the sharing of that just kind of pure joy of things that we'd all worked on for so long together. Knowing the kind of the struggles that people had gone through to get there, and the occasionally missing a friend's birthday for a test, or some other event in your life or whatever, that was the kind of the commitment that people had made, and then like to kind of get the payoff, right, which is like we did it. I think that's why it's, to me, it's as close as I've certainly experienced to kind of like communally raising, in this case, a rover, but a child, and watching it be successful and really being proud of your whole family at that moment.
Man, I bet. It seems like I just want to call out how passionate you both are about what you're doing. I mean, no wonder you feel so strongly for these rovers. I mean, they seem to have their own personalities and their own stories. And I mean, Dr. Sarojadini, how does work like what Bobak and Dr. Rice are doing, how does that inspire people back in the classroom?
Well, I'll tell you, whenever I talk about NASA and the space program and space exploration to my astronomy and astrophysics students, I always get positive feedback about how inspired they are about NASA's accomplishments in those areas. And they always ask me, how do I work at a NASA research center? How do I become a part of a space flight center? What career direction, do I need to go to be involved with NASA in some way? And it all has to, all goes back to just all the accomplishments the space agency has made in so many different areas, obviously space exploration, but also just astrophysics research and planetary research and all those things related to those areas. And students see those things, they see those successes, and they want to be a part of it. And I think it's very inspirational to a lot of our students in many ways.
Yeah, I totally hear you there. We did get a question from the audience, I think, that fits right into that. Corey Newcomer asks, and I'm going to throw this to Bobak first, but I want to hear from Jim as well. Any advice or ideas on fostering a child's interest in cosmology?
First of all, I would say, why not be an engineer instead? No, I'm kidding, but in all seriousness, I will say from a personal experience, and hearing Jim and everybody here talk as well, it's an incredible experience to be a part of, and that kind of community that you really feel a sense of in here. And I know that there is, of course, disagreements always, like all families, I guess, at some level. But that experience alone has been tremendously rewarding to me, to kind of feel like a part of a thing bigger than myself. And of course, I love the technical challenges associated with it. In terms of, you know, getting kids into it, I think obviously it's pretty like exciting on its own. I think most kids have that innate curiosity about the planets and how, you know, the world is formed and what's the nature of the universe. I think it just kind of comes naturally, and I think a lot of it is encouraging it. Obviously, there's all sorts of education, but I'd also really encourage, you know, that one of the really neat things about this field that I didn't recognize when I joined it was how broad and diverse the group of people. You know, you saw the virtual reality folks talking about putting that together, and those people, you know, not everybody in that group has an aerospace engineering background. So there's so many ways to be part of this community, whether it be, you know, cosmology or, you know, whether it be engineering or, you know, geology or whatever those fields are. But there's also the arts and, you know, the storytelling of this whole thing and the, you know, just everybody who comes together to make this work. And I think that's what's really I think the most exciting part about this. So if you love those things and you're like, I just don't, you know, math is just not my friend, fine. You know, there's plenty of other ways to participate, to join in. And I think for all kids, you know, it's kind of finding the sweet spot between what they're really excited about and what they're, you know, what things they really enjoy doing as well as a career.
What about you, Dr. Rice? What do you think when it comes to getting kids excited about, let's say, instead of just cosmology, let's expand it to just space exploration and getting involved in kind of going to the night sky?
Well, I mean, there's a lot of ways to do it. And I grew up in Alabama, and my parents encouraged me. They didn't understand really what I wanted to do, but they said, you know, if you want to do, you have to work hard at it, but you can do it. One thing they did is they, like I said, they encouraged me. My mother used to let me stay home and watch the Apollo missions on TV. And then the coverage ended, would take me into school. But they also took me to NASA centers, Marshall Space Flight Center in Huntsville. When I saw the first moon rock and the Saturn V rocket in a spacesuit, everything became so real. It wasn't just some abstract thing on TV or in a book I read. So, and if you live in Florida, you have a great place to go, Kennedy Space Center. I think that would be somewhere I would take somebody, but I would definitely foster that and build and feed it. And don't ever discourage it, because you never know, you may have the next Albert Einstein in your presence. So, I think, unfortunately, Bobak talked about the rover's children. We're born, if you ever look at a little child, they're a born scientist. They're curious. They're going everywhere, looking at everything. And it's in our DNA to be curious and to explore. And unfortunately, it seems like as your student goes through the education system, it sort of gets weeded out of you. I know I sort of experienced that with friends growing up, but I never lost my interest. So I think there's a lot of ways to do it. And, you know, there's so much now today. You know, you can watch launches virtually on the internet if you can't go see one in person. But I would tell you right now, if you get a shot, go see a launch in person. That will light a fire in you that will never go away. It's an impressive, unbelievable experience.
I totally agree. I've seen a couple launches in my time, and wow, has it been awesome. Atta, I want to get your answer on here too. Actually, the three of you, I want to get a short answer from each of you on this next final question. What do you personally hope to see for the future of Mars exploration and discovery? I'm going to start with Atta.
Well, as I said, you know, earlier in the program, I really think having humans land on Mars and actually explore the planet in much the same way that we did with the moon, to me, is at this point the holy grail of Mars exploration. Having a person on the surface of the planet doing experiments in real time on the soil and in the different parts of the planet and looking for life. I mean, to me, that would be very exciting. If we found life either right now or evidence of it from the past, it would really change our perspective of where we as a species sit within the universe.
What about you, Bobak? What do you think?
I mean, I'm very partial to rovers, just because I you know, we're talking about the personality earlier, and I really do love them in a way that I think I never would have anticipated also as a child. But maybe, I did. I don't know. Maybe I always loved robots. But you know, I think I'm obviously excited for Perseverance and Ingenuity, and just kind of seeing that that mission and the follow-on sample return. You know, for me, I do look forward to seeing humans on Mars. I really hope that, you know, when we do that, it is truly a all hands on deck kind of thing, right? Where I really want that experience to be a universal experience, as you know, Jim was talking about, you know, the Apollo experience being so powerful for folks. I want that to be something that we can all really share in and participate. So my hope is kind of for Mars, but it's also for us here on Earth who, you know, most of us won't be the first person on Mars. But I really hope that it's something that we can all really share in together and you know, use it as a platform, as I was going to talk about my love of sci-fi, of bringing it closer together, bring us all close together.
And Dr. Rice, what about you? Last word. What do you think? What's your personal hope for the future of Mars?
I agree with the others. I want to see astronauts standing on the surface of Mars. I hope I get to see it in my lifetime. It seems like it's always 20 years away, though, unfortunately. But I think a lot of great things are coming. Plans now are to get back to the moon with the Artemis program, which, if it stays on course, which depends on money, maybe get astronauts back on the moon in 2024 and use that to help build the way to get to Mars. I think there's a lot of exciting stuff coming with the commercial programs around the country. It's a very exciting time to be involved in a space program, either with NASA or these private companies out there now. So, but the number one thing, I'd like to see people on Mars. Yes.
I mean, I can't argue with that. We got three people either want a robot or a person, and two of them want people. So sorry, Babak. We'll get more robots. We'll send robots and people together. I think that'll be best of both of us. What do you say?
You're the robots.
Thank you, everyone who asked questions. We couldn't get to all of them. There were so many. So thank you so much to everyone who is watching. And of course, thanks to our guest, Dr. James Rice, Dr. Atta Sarajadini, Babak Ferdowsi, Katie Dickieson. And of course, I would like to thank our partner, Florida Atlantic University, for helping make this program possible. And thanks to everyone supporting South Florida PBS. From all of us at Stargazers, keep looking up.